What you know about black? The forum is the format. It's M-A-Z and Tomcat. Who cares who came before that? You should trust me, it's official. Don't just take the flow for granted. We discuss important issues, plus remote and local.
Now, pampering is not
pushing.
Yeah.
Flat
on.
Yeah.
Flat
pushing.
On.
Yeah.
Did
flat
you
on.
Like that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Flat
on.
Because what it did, it made me feel like, even though I was different, it made me seem like I was back.
Come on now. Yeah. Come on.
I was back.
Yeah.
They accepted me for this.
Yeah. Right on.
This was just a part of me. This wasn't me.
Right.
It's just something that was gone.
For
but
sure.
I came back.
For sure.
Yeah. You don't want to get treated no different because you ain't, because you still are you.
I'm going to tell you something. And I don't know if you experienced this. Most guys will shun big women. Now, not all guys, but I will say this. To me, you have a pretty face.
Thank you.
Very voluptuous.
Mm-hmm.
Me, you can be my queen any day.
Valentine's Day around here.
Right on time, too.
I
just got single.
It's in the air. It's in the air.
Oh,
boy. It's in the air.
I like a bottle. Even after I lost my arm, I knew I wasn't going to be the one to be over that time. Let me get a dog. Mm-hmm. You got any change? Yeah, nah, that ain't none of me.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't going to do that.
Okay.
So, and for 10 years, I didn't work. Then, they started hiring. So I knew, me being a veteran, they had to hire me. Then a friend of mine, he dead, his name Carlton Mitchell. He said, man, there ain't nothing wrong with that nigga. He said, let him light his own goddamn cigarettes. So he rushed out. I told my granddaughter the other day, I was getting ready to come down here. And I said, I don't really know how to use that phone with the GPS shit. So I said, hey, Manera, put this GPS shit on here for me. So she said, put it on there. She said, where you going, granddad? I said, I'm going down to East Point. So she said, who you going with? I said, I'm going by myself. You ain't taking, you know what I told her. I said, Manera. I said, I ain't no queen. I was born in the world by myself. It's not even different. I had a twin brother or a sister. Then I used to go somewhere with somebody. I'm used to traveling by myself. I go everywhere by myself, except when I'm hungry.
Roger,
what's one of the most, you know what I'm saying, during all your time in the service in the military, man, what's the most traumatic episode that occurred, man? What's the most traumatic thing that happened to you while you was in your time in the service, man?
You know, two things happened the day I got shot.
Okay.
When I first got shot, I didn't realize how devastating it was. Because when that AK hit me, it busted the bone, like my arm stopped there. Mm. It busted it. It flew back, and I was laying on it.
Oh.
And what I thought, I said, God, don't let me down here. And you know, it. When you get shot like that, your life flashes before you. I said, God damn, is this it? I said, God, don't let me die. But then, you know, some gunfire. Then I hear something, and I'm laying in. And so this guy walking up, and I said, wait a minute, this was one of them gooks. Mm-hmm. He checked, because see, they got overran. They had killed everybody. We had went down there, what they call R&R, Ready Reactionary Force. We done support the first or the second, and then killed everybody. Walking, bow, bow, bow. So my platoon sergeant say, well, this boot walk up, I'm laying in front of poking people. If you ain't dead, he gonna make you dead.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I'm laying there, you know what I'm saying, goddamn. Joke, this motherfucker don't shoot me. Because he poking everybody, ain't dead, gonna make them dead. Mm. When I look back, and I was telling them up there at that place where we was at, when I thought about it, I started crying. But, you know, it happened, and I'll say, had I moved, I wouldn't be here. Because what I say about that, over in Vietnam, they were shooting real bullets. Wasn't no cap gun. It was bullets. See what it did to me? Took my arm off. An AK-47 that be shoot 32 times. 32, then the way they do it, they take the magazine, clip it in there, 32, then they tape one on the bottom. So when that empty, they pour that one out and clip another one.
Shit.
So you're talking about 54 rounds. I'm talking about gone. You know, I say all that to say this. I'm grateful today that I'm sitting here.
We grateful too, man.
I'm gonna say this in close.
Right.
You know, I'm a veteran. And when I go up to that VA hospital, a black veteran, I want to look at me. Look at me, yeah, I'm black. And a white guy asked me the last time I was up there last year. I had my long mink on. He said, that real? I said, what you mean is it real? I say, I'm real. I don't wear no fake shit. I got Louis Vuitton luggage.
Okay.
That's what I got. When I travel.
Traveling style.
LV, that's the only way I
go. He's my hero, man.
Bruh.
He's my new hero.
What you was talking?
You think cuz was mad at me before for spending money? Wait, God.
This is what I say about me. I got one arm, and I know that. But when I leave here and go out and I get my car washed, I might stop at a store. And I go in and they say, hey, look, see, I got one. I say, hey, baby, don't worry about me. I got one arm. You got two. What you need? What you need something? I do this all the time. I go down to a casino. I might lose 500. As a matter of fact, on my way back, I'm going to stop down there. Bet at the Motor City Casino. Nah, I go down there sometime.
Now, if you hit big, it's because of platform, and I just want that little piece in
little
there.
Little percentage
in
there.
Yeah,
a little bit.
You got his number.
I might as well be honest. I'm going to come back and get one person when I win. Get to.
Are we Okay,
and my dad is.
But you know what?
Is.
Don't forget to include her too, though.
Time period when you came up, it was a whole lot of, you know, as far as the civil rights. Now you got one arm, you went to service, like you got a whole lot of things going against you. Like how did that play out for you? Like, you know what I mean? How was the, you know what I mean, the whole climate and everything around that time?
Being a black man.
Yeah.
I'm gonna say this. I had a white friend of mine that lived in Dearborn down there by Montgomery Ward. You know what that used to be?
I do.
Coming down Michigan, Montgomery Ward's on the right side, turn and go down. My buddy's down about a quarter of a mile. I had lost my arm then.
Mm-hmm.
He and I had went, he was in the Army too, but he didn't get hurt.
Okay.
So he knew me, we knew how to eat up before we went. So I go down there and deal with him. I used to stay in the two family flat. Go up his steps, down his, another white family. Okay. I've been on about one day, we sitting upstairs, me and Larry, smoking a joint. He looked out the window and said, oh, he said, get in the bathroom. I ain't got to use no bathroom. I mean, get in the bathroom. The white man come. The owner of the house, the people downstairs, had called him and said, it's a nigga upstairs. The guy upstairs, he got a nigga up there. I'm in the bathroom. When they go, my old white guy, hair red, face red, hair thin, but it's white, he got a cat leg. He comes and tell Larry, say, they say you got one, you been had one of them coming over here. Larry said, one of what? He said, you know what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. I know what you're saying. Mm-hmm. You got one of them niggas here coming over here. So Larry say, no, I ain't. So I'm offended by what he's saying because I'm hearing it. Right. I lost my arm. I come out. I come out the bathroom. He's standing right there. I say, how you doing, sir? You know, I ain't mad with him. Mm-hmm. I'm a veteran.
Right.
How you doing, sir?
Mm-hmm.
He wouldn't shake my hand. Mm-hmm. You know what he told me? You know you ain't supposed to be down. Wait a minute. Larry, that's what Larry said. Larry said, Roger, I got it. He said, now he told the white guy, he said he lost his arm in Vietnam. The guy said, I don't give a damn what you do. He don't belong down here.
You know what the f-
Now this is a white man. I'm about 21. I lost my arm in Dearborn. This hunky telling me I don't belong to it. And my arm gone.
Wow.
Now, wait a minute. I live right down the street in Rumpus. He telling me I don't belong down here. Oh, wait a minute. Now, I'm going to say something, too. During them 10 years, that hunky down there in Dearborn, he lit something in me. Come see him. I knew I didn't deserve what he said to me. He spit on me. What I'm finna say, I ain't. But I robbed. You know what Malcolm X said? By any means necessary. And I took that literally.
The dancer.
Yeah.
I had a pistol. Me and some friends of mine, I used to, out there where I live at that hotel, Marion Road, we used to be out there. We drive and we go steal a car. Go to the airport, catch some monkeys over there. I had a friend of mine, big red, big yellow guy. See, I couldn't get out because they know me. I had run out. I drove. Big Red said, that one go. Pull up. I let him out. He was a big guy. He come back. Hit that hunky like woman, bitch, give me that purse.
But that reminds me of a segment we did the other time about reverse racism. Like, if you could go back, would you reverse it and put them into black people's perspective?
No, I wouldn't. No? No, I wouldn't. And the reason I wouldn't is because being a humanitarian, if you were white, I would still like you.
Because it's the person, not the color.
It ain't the color.
Right.
It's the person. I'm going to say this to you. I got a white girl that I work with named Karen.
Oh, I believe you.
She retired. She's an electrician in the plant. Her dad died. It's February. Her dad died in Christmas, around Christmas time. But what I'm finna say is, she liked me, and I like her. And I'm married. I've been married 53 years.
Wow. Don't say that to me.
No, you don't know.
I got a daughter, 53. I got a daughter, 49. And I got a son, Amir, is 40. But I got 6 grandkids and 6 great grandkids.
Yeah. Okay, okay.
I got 2 twin granddaughters. That's 35. Their mother, my daughter, is 53. She taking them to Florida for their 35th birthday.
You look a very beautiful man. Yeah,
that's pretty, pretty cool, man.
But I say all that to say this. The embellishment of my family, and when I say embellishment, decorations that are around them are put there by me.
Yeah.
That leaves me my question. I don't know what we're looking like on time, Roger, but man, I mean, aside from, because I mean, that big, beautiful family you got, that's enough of a legacy, but besides that, besides your people, man, your grandkids, great-grandkids, what do you want people to remember you by, man? What's your legacy, man? What Roger stand for?
I'm going to say this. I ran a race. 30 years in the making, a 30-year race. Somewhere along the way, when it started up there at GM, one day, when I first got that job, with me having one arm, that first day I went, I'm just working. I'm trying to show everybody I don't need no help. I don't want nobody to give me nothing. I'm here to do a job just like you. But I did it. I overdid it. Man, I tell you. On the way home, I had to pull over on the side of the road. My head hurt so bad.
Working like a motherfucker.
Just working, you know. See, it's different. You got 2 hands. You can kind of interchange them. You can pick this up, and then you put this in your mind.
You're doing double work.
Hey, man, this hand is wrong. But what I'll say, my legacy is I ran the race. Along the way, I failed. And I said, I ain't gonna get up. I quit. And so I don't go to church. Leaving somebody other than myself.
Mm-hmm. Right on.
Now, when I sit there on the side of the road, and I tell you I'm crying, I got my family, I told my wife, I got the job. I don't want to let her down and say I can't do it. Mm-hmm. But I'm pushing, man. I got one hand. Everybody else in there got 2 hands. I'm living shit. They living now. I done bit off more than I could chew. Some said never heard that thing say, that you see somebody can you, but you look back, you don't see no footprints.
That's right.
And I say, wait a minute. And me and not a religious person, as I got closer and closer to the finish line, I say 30 years. Looking back, I said, wait a minute, how I get here? And my wife, my son, my friends, and I ain't giving all praise to who did it. I can't see him. I ain't heard him. I thought I heard him. But then when I get to the line, September 14th, my mother's birthday, I was standing at her house. She died. I said, Ma, I'm the patriarch of this family. I'm the oldest boy. Are you proud of me? I worked. I didn't ask nobody for nothing. I worked at them for 30 years. It hurt me every day to do that. But I did it. I crossed the finish line. When I turned around and I saw a tree, a big tree, and I say, Mom, I say, you see me? Yes, sir. I say, standing on your shoulders, Ma. I'm proud to be your son. Ma, I'm your oldest boy. I finished the line. I finished the race, Ma. I almost done. But I say this. I'm glad I finished. Now I'm gonna say this.
Yes, sir.
I'm 100% disabled. Social Security disability, and I get a pension from GM. My wife get a pension from Forbes. Now Social Security, me. How much do you think I get a year?
I couldn't even guess.
I ain't got no job. I don't want them.
Got the pension.
Wait a minute. That's what I say. But if I was going to work anywhere, I would be working in GM.
Right.
Because, see, when I worked out, I was making $32 an hour. He made $15 now, or $16. I give you $19.
Mm-hmm.
You ain't going to never make what I'm making. Never.
Right, I got one more for you, man.
Go ahead.
So, I don't know how many like friends you got left from like the Vietnam and all of that, but I know that you like pay tribute every year and you go to the memorial. Like, what drives you? First of all, do you have any friends left from that, and what drives you to keep going to the memorial every year?
Man, you don't know. A friend of mine just died. Jerry Carter. Vietnam veteran, was married. Right now I have what they call post-traumatic stress syndrome. It'll never go away. What that is what the psychologists and the therapists say it is. When you experience a traumatic thing in your life, whether it's an accident, a death, a loss, you grieve it, but you don't never fully understand and grieve it completely. The other day, my granddaughter, when I asked her to put that thing on my phone, she was down there and she looked at me. She said, Granddad, where you trying to go? I said, my dear, I say, I met a guy that wanted me to do a podcast. I didn't know what it was. And she said, well, you gonna go? I said, you know what? I said, yeah, maybe I will. Because I had thought about not. Not because I didn't want it. I thought it might snow.
Mm-hmm.
And I come away out by the airport. Okay. See, I come all the way. When I left my house, it said turn on the Ecorse Road. Go straight down, get on the freeway, go east. And all the way to East Point. Mm-hmm. I left home at 12 o'clock. And I got here at 12:25. I pulled up out there in the front of the warehouse there. I looked at the old Eddie right there. Then I went down the road, you know, kind of familiarized myself. Then I went back out and I was looking somewhere to wash my truck.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see no car wash out there. Yeah. Then I went up there by that BP gas station. I called my grandson. He said, "Granddad, where you at? Some on these things." He wanted to come down here with me, but today is Valentine's Day. So he with his girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
Now, hear what I say about today in this situation I find myself in. I'm grateful for the opportunity to meet you, as well as you, my friend,
yes, sir,
and the guy that I met at the truck stop. This is something that should be more exposed because a lot of black people don't know that this exists. And I don't know how you can amplify this to the masses. But to give me a platform to speak like I am, I think a lot of more people would be relished to the fact that this is on a podcast. So if I want to look at this, how do I do it?
You can go on YouTube, man. YouTube, and you can actually watch this anytime you want to. Tell
me. Love, like, share, subscribe.
Please like, share. Damn.
Like, share, subscribe. Man. Because.